You're watching.
And feel your boomerang.
Enough to steal your boomerang.
What the hell is going on, Peggy Sue? One week you say if you love me, you won't. The next week you say if you love me, you will.
Those are scenes from three of the movies we'll be reviewing this week. I'm Bill Harris.
And I'm Rex Reed. And you are at the movies.
Well, stick around and maybe you will find out. Right now, though, Rex starts us off with a story about a disgruntled housewife who finds a way to change the past in Peggy Sue Got Married.
Peggy Sue Got Married stars the incomparable Kathleen Turner. Now, that's a good enough reason to see any movie, but this one is doubly special. It's funny, wise, touching, adventurous in spirit and tone, and, in my opinion, it's Francis Ford Coppola's best film since The Godfather. In a nutshell, Peggy Sue is an all-American girl going haywire. Wife, mother, businesswoman. She faces divorce, middle age, she's unhappy, and she reluctantly attends her 25th high school reunion saying, if I only knew then what I know now, I'd do it all differently. I wouldn't make the same mistakes this time. Well, in the excitement, she passes out in the gym, and when she wakes up, it's 1960, and everyone is 18 again. But what a difference. This time, Peggy Sue knows all about space travel, microwave ovens, abortions, heart transplants. Her classmates, meanwhile, are all twirling batons and mooning over Fabian. Well, the comic possibilities here are limitless. Take this scene, for example. The family is buying a new car, but only Peggy Sue knows it's a lemon.
Wow, it's cool.
Ta-da!
Wait till I tell Diane. She's always bragging about her dad's Cadillac.
What do you think, Peggy Sue?
Oh, Dad, you were always doing stuff like that. It's funny. It's really funny. You bought an Edsel.
Evelita, what's the matter with you? Are you drunk?
Just a little. I had a tough day.
Even a date with the man she knows she's going to marry in the future takes on a different slant when a girl's got 25 years of sexual experience and the boy doesn't know it.
Charlie, let's make love.
What? You mean sex? Intercourse. You want to have intercourse? Last week, and you said, what time is it? Holy cow, it's late, real late. Come on, what is this? What the hell is going on, Peggy Sue? One week you say, if you love me, you won't. The next week you say, if you love me, you will. That's a guy's line.
Using her knowledge of the future, Peggy Sue decides to change the events of her youth and alter her own history. But this only confuses poor Charlie, who doesn't know what she's talking about.
It's over, Charlie. I don't want to hurt you. I want you to be happy.
But no, I will be happy if I have you. I love you.
No, that doesn't make any difference. We just can't live together. And you went off with that bimbo, Janet.
What are you talking about? Who is Janet?
I just can't trust you.
Imagine this dilemma. This girl is like Judy Garland trying to get back to Kansas in The Wizard of Oz, and how she comes unstuck in time and returns to the present is just part of this movie's charm and magic. But most important, what Coppola seems to be saying here is be selective in your life. Hold on to the things that matter, the experiences of lasting value. Peggy Sue does learn that the choices she made are not so bad after all. Now, as a person who often feels like he's living in the wrong period, this movie really appealed to me enormously. I've got a schoolboy crush on Kathleen Turner, I admit it. She's like Lana Turner. 1960 also was my high school period, so what a dream to go back again and see it through fresh eyes. Frankly, I'm not sure I can even assess this experience rationally, because I admit this too, I saw most of it through a veil of tears. But that's about the highest praise you're likely to get on this program from me.
It's true. And I have to say, Rex, you old softy, good for you. I'm even happy to hear that. Speaking about being selective.
This girl makes me cry.
Oh, I love her. She was just wonderful. But look what he did with his casting. Nicolas Cage, I wasn't crazy about. But you say, be selective, Rex. Look at Leon Ames and Maureen O'Sullivan and Don Murray.
And wonderful to see Barbara Harris on the screen again as the mother.
And something that means
something. It starts off kind of like Back to the Future, but it ends up like Our Town. And you get the nostalgia of what it was like in your past.
You do. And it is a Back to the Future for romantics, though. I was happy, I was warmed, it was emotional. Her little sister, Sofia Coppola, obviously more family, talk about how time flies. She played the baby in The Godfather. Ooh.
Well, I thought they were all wonderful, and so is this movie.
Yes, absolutely it is. I look forward to more like that anytime. Coming up next, what do you have when a bunch of guys get together to complain about women? Well, you have the men's club.
Girls, I'm here.
The campaign for the Men's Club boasts that it's the cinema successor to The Breakfast Club and The Big Chill. Now, admittedly, all three films start with the word the, and each has some cast members whose names you can't possibly remember, but that's about it. This new club has seven members. They're friends and professionals who band together for the very first time, and, big surprise, they end up talking about the women in their lives and in their past. In alphabetical order, the stars are David Dukes, Richard Jordan, Harvey Keitel, Frank Langella, Roy Scheider, Craig Wasson, and Treat Williams. As we're first meeting the members, a mysteriously stricken Frank Langella is dramatically diagnosed and treated by Treat Williams as a wise and kindly physician.
I mean, me, of all people, I don't even catch cold.
Can you move?
No, I don't think so.
I've seen this before. Usually with the women or children in cases of severe shock. Kathy, get the ice.
Big bag?
Yeah. Lie very still. Don't move.
I can't move. I'm paralyzed.
The members all get paralyzed together with booze later on when the real revelry begins at Richard Jordan's house. It's mindless fun and dangerous game.
I've never done that.
You're an Indian. Let's see you can beat that.
I think so.
Come on, let's go.
Then our boys head for the House of Affection for a late night buffet of bimbos. When Harvey Keitel wants to marry his maiden, and Scheider complains they're all the same.
Just one long, 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 empty ceremony. I need something more. I need something real.
You protest too much, Kavanaugh. As far as I can see, this ceremony is the realest thing you know. You're no different from them. You're a husband. And the worst kind, too. Kind who never stops thinking he's a lover.
There are few things more disappointing than a story or a film with great promise that, instead of soaring, takes a nosedive right into the dumper. The shame is the men's club takes the film's stars right along with it, and your hopes, and worse yet, your ticket money. Now, some of them struggle bravely. Scheider, Langella, and Keitel stand out for me, but it says nothing. It does nothing, and it means nothing. After they've all gotten drunk, and they've played their young men's fantasies with the hookers, they go off on their next harebrained adventure, having wasted their whole night and a good part of mine. If the men's club doesn't go straight into the dumper, it ends up going nowhere. And that's even worse.
And I can't think of anything worse than the men's club. I mean, I saw this picture in a movie theater instead of a screening room. There were four people in the theater, and two of them were sound asleep, and the other two were talking all the way through the picture, bored out of their skulls. This picture is without substance. It's without merit. It has no redeeming social factors at all going for it. Good actors, totally wasted, but these mewling, whining adolescents, the men have nothing to tell you. When they start to tell you their stories in the consciousness-raising session, what is the worst thing that ever happened to him? Some girl ate this man's dessert.
The strawberries from his dessert.
I couldn't believe that I was sitting in a movie in which a man is telling you how his life has failed because some girl put her fork in his dessert.
Didn't you have the feeling there was something there that they should have been able to come up with a good movie
anyway? One great scene, Stockard Channing walks in and bangs her husband over the head with a frying pan, and I yelled, "Hit him again!"
I said, hit the other six of them. If you're going to start hitting Stockard, hit them all. No, thank you. This one misses with me, too.
Coming up next, a better film, William Hurt, as a teacher of the deaf in Children of a Lesser God.
Stupid hearing people think that deaf people are stupid.
Have you ever wondered what it would be like to be deaf? It's a strange and frightening world. It's isolated by the sound of silence. Children of a Lesser God is an unusual movie that attempts to explore that mysterious landscape. William Hurt plays a compassionate teacher in a school for the deaf whose teaching methods are unorthodox. He plays rock and roll. He stands on his head. He makes trendy references to everything from Benji the dog to Princess Di in order to bring his students out of the darkness. And in the process, he meets Sarah, a beautiful girl who uses her deafness as a fortress against the outside world. She's beautiful. She's angry. She's a challenge. Naturally, they fall in love. William Hurt's marathon performance is varied and colorful, as you can see from this scene with a classroom of his deaf students.
Reasons to talk. Right. If your hands are occupied, for example, some guy owes you money. He comes by, but you just happen to be in a handstand. How are you going to tell him to give you your money? You can't use your hands. You've got to speak. Give me my money, you bum. Oh, call me names, will you? I don't have to stand here and take that. You want to fight, huh? Okay, put up your feet, fight like a man.
Things we all take for granted in our lives take on painful new meanings for the deaf. Imagine a world without music. Here, a young student learns the joy of a song by feeling vibrations.
Can you feel that? Good.
Feel it.
Like a boomerang, baby, ba-boomerang, rang, rang. Two, three, four, ba-boomerang, rang. Use your voice. Boomerang, rang, yeah. Ba-boomerang.
The breakthroughs are amazing, but Sarah remains an enigma. It's a case that refuses to be solved. She even teaches the teacher a few things.
You're smart as hell, you know. You want to dance? Can you feel it? Vibrations through your nose. I'm not good at this. You are. Great.
At the risk of sounding churlish, I have to tell you, this is a well-intentioned film. It has heart, but it doesn't build with any thrust. William Hurt does bring a variety of attitudes and textures to a really demanding role, and this girl, Marley Matlin, an actress who really is deaf, makes a stunning debut. Piper Laurie, excellent, in the small role of her cynical mother. And all of those hearing-impaired performers who play the deaf students are courageous, they're admirable, but there's something irritating and eventually even boring about a one-sided conversation that goes on for 2 hours. The love affair part of the movie is very conventional. They fight, they feel imprisoned by their lack of communication, they break up, they go back together. We've seen it before. What this is a two-character movie in which one character does all the talking, and the result is like the sound of one hand clapping. It falls on deaf ears.
Well, only with one of us, this is the sound of two hands clapping. I loved Children of a Lesser God. It's one of my favorites of the year. I thought, more aside from the deaf aspect of the film, which is charming and wonderful and interesting and certainly matters to 18 million hearing-impaired Americans, it was a love story to me, and a romantic one, and I found William Hurt wonderful as always, but this new Marley Matlin, my favorite actress in the world.
Well, she's very good, and I think the film teaches you a lot about deaf people and what it's like to live in that terrifying world, but it doesn't teach you very much about good filmmaking. The film really doesn't move. It doesn't give Hurt any real energy. He brings the energy to the film. The film doesn't return it to him.
He does carry us along.
The script is awfully slow. I have sympathy for the hearing impaired, and I really think this is a movie that's nice. It's not a terrible movie, but it just isn't a movie that held my interest for very long.
I know that you were disappointed because Hurt has to carry her conversation and verbalize it, and that slows it down.
When he gets on the telephone and he's carrying on three conversations at once in sign language, I thought it was time to look at my watch. Now, maybe if this movie had starred Kathleen Turner,
you'd have watched in a second. Yeah. Well, it was a love story for me, and a fine one, and a real honest one. I was just real impressed.
You're the softy this time.
I guess I am. Coming up next, The Magic of Believing casts a spell over an entire town. The movie is The Boy Who Could Fly.
Did he tell you that Eric could fly?
Yeah.
Thing against motion pictures that dare to call themselves very special motion pictures before the public even has a chance to vote. But I have to admit, The Boy Who Could Fly comes close to qualifying. First of all, the title has no hidden meaning. We're taking advantage of everyone's dream at one time or another to soar above it all. Bonnie Bedelia's the just-widowed young mom who brings her two kids, Lucy Deakins and Fred Savage, to a brand new neighborhood. With their new house comes a mysterious new neighbor. Jay Underwood plays an autistic orphan named Eric, who may or may not be able to do the absolutely impossible.
Eric. How'd you get in here?
Colleen Dewhurst is the kindly schoolteacher who's taken a personal interest in the strange young boy. She knows he's different, and she hopes Eric may have a new friend.
A while ago, his uncle went on a binge, and they did put Eric away for about a month. He got sick, very sick. He was dying. No one knew why, but I was convinced that he had just given up. I promised them then that I would watch over him. But I can't be with him all the time. Anyway, I was hoping maybe you'd help.
Mrs. Sherman, I don't know anything about those kind of kids.
You don't have to. All you have to do is be yourself.
Well, if they didn't want me to give it away, they'd have called the movie The Boy Who May or May Not Be Able to Fly. As it is, of course he can fly. and those scenes are sensational. And while he shares his secret with the young girlfriend, the movie builds until he reveals that talent to the whole town. Familiar co-stars Dewhurst, Fred Gwynne, and TV's Mindy Cohn support these starring young newcomers, all three of whom I thought were terrific. The boy who could fly drags on the ground far too long. But knocking this little feel-good film of simple love and faith and courage would make me feel like the uneasy judge sitting in judgment on the Santa Claus case in Miracle on 34th Street. So, I liked it.
Well, I didn't hate it for a change. It's a movie about kids that I really didn't mind, but I wonder if it's going to have a traumatic effect on kids, because a lot of tough things happen in this picture. It's not all fun and games. A family pet gets hit by a car while it's being scolded by a child. A father commits suicide. A neighbor goes to an insane asylum. These are traumatic things
for
children.
It's not all a happy movie, but the moral, things can happen for the positive if you want them to happen and believe enough. And good things happen. The little kid beats the school bullies, Fred Savage, who's great. The girl settled. Things happen.
A bit contrived, but actually, think of all the kids who are going to want to fly. That's their dream. They're going to jump off their high school gymnasiums, and they're going to end up in Fort Lauderdale? No, I don't think so. But let's review the movies on this show. I loved Kathleen Turner's Backward Time Travel and Peggy Sue Got Married, so it got my highest rating. 4 stars. Bill liked it, too. He gives it 3.5 stars. But The Whining Adolescents and The Men's Club, yuck. No appeal for me. 0 stars. Bill thought the whole club sank in this go-nowhere movie, too. He gives it 1.5 stars. Though I thought Marley Matlin made a stunning debut in Children of a Lesser God, the movie didn't go far enough, so it only got 2.5 stars for me, whereas Bill really fell for it. He said this unusual love story is one of his favorite films of the year. 4 whole stars from Bill. And The Boy Who Could Fly inspired me to the tune of 2 stars. Bill thought it flew a little higher. 3 stars from him.
That was it. But next week, the movies of the director that Robert De Niro seems unable to say no to, Martin Scorsese. We'll be recounting his career, and Rex will be talking to the man himself. Until then, I'm Bill Harris.
And I'm Rex Reed. And we'll be seeing you at the movies.